Dancer Kurt? I see the head wiggling. Oh, you got the smooth move going. Excellent. Welcome, everybody, to Noon on Tuesday. I am your host, Gina, from Venissimo. And I think we'll all agree that pedophiles are bad, but turophiles are awesome. They're the best people in the world. And if you're wondering what a turophile is, that is a cheese lover. So today, if you happen to be an aspiring cheese maker or simply love cheese, then Queso Diego is the club you need to learn about. And I am here with Kurt Wittenberg, who is an avid and active member of Queso Diego. Welcome, Kurt.
Thank you very much. Glad to be here.
Yeah, thanks for coming. Thank you for coming. So, Kurt, I guess let's start by tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I am an avid cheese maker, as you say, but I also am an avid fermenter of all sorts.
Fermenter of all things.
I love fermenting vegetables, and I love fermenting beer, and I love fermenting cider, and I love the fermentation process, and I love the product.
So one thing led to another. What did you ferment first?
I think that I probably first fermented blackberries back in college when I lived near a blackberry vine.
So nice.
That was probably how I got started.
How you got started.
That didn't turn out too well.
I was going to say, did you turn that into wine? What did we turn it into?
It was for wine.
Okay, very good, but not too well.
It
sounds good.
But I have, really in the past 6-7 years, I've really gotten into various forms of fermentation, and I'm a yeast geneticist, so I know a few things about fermenting things. And it was a natural
progression. This is good, because I did notice you're also a member of QAF, which is a big beer brewing society club, right?
True, and I'm a member of two beer clubs, Society of Barley Engineers and QAF.
Yeah. Oh, that is really good, Kurt. Do you remember Shauna Doty that used to live here? Was this back? I'm not sure how long. Or okay, because she was in QAF. Anyway, another went on to cheese making and became a cheesemaker. And interesting. Okay, very good. How did you fall in love with cheese then? It was like you said, it was natural. Did you love cheese before and said?
That's another evolution, right? Started with Velveeta, I'm sure.
Oh, everybody does. Kraft Singles, Velveeta.
And then I've always loved cheese. I've eaten a lot of cheese throughout my life. Yeah. But I think, again, my real passion for cheese started when I started making cheese.
Yeah.
Just like my passion for beer. I was a beer drinker, but not a very diverse beer drinker.
Yeah.
But when I started making the foods, I started
really opened the eyes
and looking really deep into them. So that's sort of I'm passionate about things I get into
go for it.
I just get deep into it.
Deep in and then away you go. Do you recall what your first cheese was that you made?
My first cheeses were ricottas and other fresh cheeses.
Yeah.
You know, Chev.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the way I get into hobbies is I look at something and I say to myself, wow, you can make that at home. That sounds
great.
I
should do it.
I should try that. And then I do it a few times, and if it goes well, then I start really
really delving in. Yeah, that's so awesome.
That's sort of how this went.
And how it goes.
It started to be Blumy Rind cheeses.
Yeah.
And I realized I needed a cheese cave, and then I realized I
could
age cheeses.
Mm-hmm.
And it goes from there.
And it goes from there.
Right.
Let me ask you this, Kurt, because it's happened to me. Mozzarella. How many have you failed at these batches?
So,
or is it just me?
So one of my first cheeses was a mozzarella. I did the simple mozzarella first. It seemed to turn out pretty well.
Yeah.
Didn't have much of a flavor profile, so I decided, well, I'm going to do the real bacterial acidification of the mozzarella instead of acidifying it with acid.
Okay.
And when I did that, I overshot. And what happens then is you cannot stretch the cheese.
Okay,
and
shoot.
And then it got salted and became a really bad feta.
It really so no stretch and no. I was going to say, did it turn into a rubber ball? I've had that happen before, too much stretch, too rubbery.
No, it just broke every time I'd go to stretch it, and so I never got any
stretchedness
to it.
It can be maddening, right?
It was indeed.
I leave that to the professionals, personally.
I don't know. Interestingly, now I've made all kinds of cheeses.
Yeah.
I've never gone back to mozzarella. I've never made another mozzarella.
Right. Kind of again, why would you when you can do all these other things?
Exactly.
That is really good. Is that what led you to Queso Diego?
So that was then soon after that, because of the association mm-hmm. through the beer club. If you know, Queso Diego was born out of Coif.
Yep.
And mm-hmm. And so I heard about Queso Diego through some Coif members.
Okay.
And thought I should try it.
Yeah.
And one thing led to another, and here I am.
And here you are. So have you been around since its inception, which is now 2000, what year, 9?
So we're in our sixth year, I believe. 2012 was when it officially started.
Okay.
So the club was born out of Coif, as I mm-hmm. said, and it was really started apparently by a cheese class that was offered to Coif members by Horace Bixby, who was known as
Horace,
Bix,
yes, exactly. Good memories.
Sadly mm-hmm. now. And he and Chris Banker evolved this idea of a cheese club over a year or so. And
sure.
in 2012, the club started officially, and now
yeah.
we are moving along.
Moving along, good. There's a lot of members.
Yes.
Like it's every month, more and more members.
Exactly.
Cheese lovers, cheese makers.
And I don't have an accurate number right now, but I know we should be right at about 100 or a little over.
That's really great for just a local, casual, right, get-together type club. How often do you guys meet?
So we meet once a month, mm-hmm. and we meet at Ale Smith Brewing Company.
Great
and
location.
And it is the third Tuesday of the month.
Mm-hmm.
Always forget to say this, and it's at 6:30 p.m., and the meetings are relatively informal, but we always have a formal presentation of some sort. We talk about cheese, and we share cheese, and you can eat dinner every month at the club by just showing up and coming together,
so and I assume some good beers, too.
And there's great beer at Ale Smith, and then people bring beer, and people bring their own fermented beverages.
Oh, nice. Super group. I've noticed a lot focuses on cheese making, which is fun. I see like lots of different people teaching different elements of cheese making, people sharing their just their passion for it or their mistakes, you know. And I think that's so valuable when I'll read the little, you know, feed and be like, oh, I would suggest you don't do this, but I suggest you use that. So it really is helpful for someone just trying to dabble into cheese making. Yeah,
indeed. And mm-hmm. I meet people all the time who learn that I make cheese, and they say, oh, I've been meaning to do that. And it's really hard to get over the mm-hmm. first barriers. Most people who are interested in cheese have made a chèvre or
exactly,
a
like
ricotta
said, mm-hmm.
or even a queso fresco or something like that. But they've never done anything further than that. And it's a step. So we try and make that step really easy for people.
Mm-hmm.
There's cheese making classes associated with the club.
That's super.
Larry Stein teaches most of mm-hmm. our cheese making classes, and they're excellent and they're relatively inexpensive. There's a discussion, an open discussion of problems that people have had with cheese making every time we meet. And there's, you know, about half the presentations are in some aspect of cheese styles, cheese making, et cetera.
Yeah. So helpful.
It's super helpful.
Yeah.
And you know, I say that the club is made up of cheese lovers,
mm-hmm.
some of whom are cheese makers, not all of whom.
Sure.
And
you don't have to be by any means,
don't
right?
You at all have to be. You
mm-hmm.
can come share cheeses that other people have made, professionals.
Yeah.
If you want to come to the meeting and share something, you can participate in all the events of the club without making cheese. But we're trying to encourage more cheese making.
It's really great. I have to say, we've come a long way for cheese making in this city, because I've been a judge at the state fair, and they just started a few years ago. You know, home cheesemakers would submit their cheeses.
Yep.
And I'm going to be frightfully honest, the first year was not good. Okay, there were a couple good ones in there. But this last time, wow, there were some spectacular cheeses.
Yep.
I cannot even say, I'm like thinking to myself, somebody made this at home? That is crazy. And I was just in awe. I just wanted to, you know, hats off, pat on the back, floored.
That goes back to what I said about getting into cheese making myself.
Yeah.
It's like I go, wow, I have something. And I say, you can do this at home.
Yeah.
You know, and that's how I've gotten into all my hobbies.
Into the hobbies, yeah. And then it leads on. Have you entered into the fair?
I have.
Because I never know
the
names of who.
The county fair.
Uh-huh.
So this year, the club actually took mm-hmm. over the cheese competition.
The whole thing. Oh, they did. Okay,
yeah, so
running the whole thing.
We're now in charge of the
makes
cheese
good
competition.
Sense. Mm-hmm.
It's great. We got Jenny Eastwood from Small Goods involved,
nice.
And she's a certified cheese judge.
Perfect.
And she recruits a bunch of other mm-hmm. people who have significant experience yeah. or are certified cheese judges. And
Perfect.
So the fair competition
yeah.
has really taken a step up. And,
That's good.
We'd love to have more people submitting their cheeses. Mm-hmm. We know there's lots of people outside the club that are making great cheeses.
Right.
So that would be great to have more people participate.
To do that. Did you win this year? Did you
I
any of yours?
I won several medals.
Yes. Yeah.
I entered five cheeses, and I can't remember if I won for all of them, but I won for won something for most of them.
Oh, this is good.
But there
this
were a
good.
Small number of cheeses, I will admit.
Okay, was there still the category, I want to say it was vegan cheeses?
I don't know that there was.
Do you recall?
Was.
Okay. Good, because I have a very good position on that I don't really think that that's cheese. So, good. That's good to hear.
It's a different
Things
product.
There's been progress.
It may
progress.
Taste good, but it's a different product.
Yeah, right. That's really true. That's
yep.
really true.
Yep.
What was, of the ones you made this year, did you have an absolute favorite? That's something that you're super proud of?
Well, you know, the cheeses I have been most successful mm-hmm. with, although I must admit I have a hard time controlling their ripeness, are my Bloomy Rind cheeses.
Our Bloomies. Okay.
And I love Bloomy Rind cheeses.
Oh, yeah.
And I have just started in the last year making Valençay.
You have.
Which mm. I love, and I love when it ripens up and the bloom comes through the ash.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get that little yellowing. And
yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's wonderful to see it. Now, this brings us to the issue of the Library of Cheesemaking. I don't
mm-hmm.
know if you want to get to that.
I do want to talk about that because you're building one, is my understanding, Queso Diego.
So the big deal for me was we now have cheese forms, or some people call them mm-hmm. molds, but
yeah.
I try not to confuse them with cultures.
Sure.
So we have cheese forms mm-hmm. Available to club members, and we have cheese molds and bacterial cultures available
yeah.
to club members.
Oh, that's
and
so nice.
The story is that the Berry Good Food Foundation, and really facilitated by our sort of sustainability guru, Jack Ford
yeah.
of Taj Farms.
Hats off to Jack for everything
really
he's done.
Promoted
yeah.
the club and really helped us
yeah.
out in terms of supporting the club through the Berry Good Food Foundation.
Mm-hmm.
And that has enabled us to both obtain from members and from Jack and from by purchasing all kinds of different cheese making equipment. So
oh, that's
we have
nice.
Almost a couple hundred, I think, maybe 150 cheese forms
oh,
of, for
wow.
all different styles of cheeses that are available to members to be checked out.
Yep, just like a library.
We have cheese presses. Huh. We have expendable goods as well. So we have supplies like cheesecloth and ash and
oh wow
annatto
yeah.
and all kinds of things you might need for making all different kinds of cheeses, and then
mm-hmm.
we have more than 20 different kinds of cultures available, and I've taken the responsibility that we split those
mm-hmm.
into small portions, because one of the biggest barriers to cheese making and making cheese types of cheeses that you haven't made before is getting the right cultures to
sure.
do it and getting the right forms
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
We want to break down those barriers. And
right.
one of the problems
awesome.
With getting cultures is they come in big packages that are generally made for commercial
sure.
batches. So unless you have someone to break them down into small one or two batch, you know, several gallon
yeah.
amounts, then you're not going to get those.
Exactly.
And so we are doing that and making those available. So we
nice.
Have all different kinds of molds and bacterial
right.
cultures for all different kinds of cheeses.
All different kinds.
Right.
So you can really dabble without
and
a huge investment, and you're just
exactly.
like, oh, do I really like this?
Exactly.
You know, and which way do I want to go?
So then
and
you start making things that you never thought of making before because you knew you were going to have to pay $35 for a
mm-hmm.
enough culture to make your
sure.
1 gallon of
milk. Exactly.
Of milk.
And then I need the milk,
so,
and then I want this. Yeah.
Exactly.
It gets crazy. Are you the chief librarian of the
Well, so the library was set up by Larry Stein, Chris
mm-hmm.
Banker, and myself.
Oh, nice.
And it is done online. Requests are done online. And then we each have pieces of the library,
yeah.
and we bring them to
and
the
bring
meeting
it to the next meeting
if someone has signed up.
That is super
and,
cool.
And we literally charge $1 for enough yeah. of a culture to make a couple gallons worth of
You can't
milk.
Beat that. Yeah.
And
can't beat it.
You know, it's great.
Oh,
it's
that's
it's
good.
All about access. And so
yeah.
We're hoping to make more cheese lovers into cheese makers,
mm-hmm.
but we love the cheese lovers too.
Right. Yes, exactly. Because the cheese lovers will eat what you make. Exactly. And I'm all for the cheese makers because I'm in awe. I mean, it definitely is,
thanks.
I think, a labor of love.
Thanks. We love it. Yeah.
And it's, you know, but I will do my part to make sure everybody eats it. Definitely.
Indeed.
Because it's so good.
Indeed.
Benissimo
obviously is a great resource around town.
Thank you. You know, I love cheese.
Yep.
I just love eating it. But I'm scared to. I've not learned the art and science of fermentation of things, you know, except like maybe pickling something. So to me, all that science part kind of scares me away. So making is daunting. Like I'm nervous to make it, and I've had some epic fails with mozzarella. So I'm like, oh, now I'm scared to try to the next one. But it sounds like, you know, something like this.
I say get away from mozzarella because mozzarella is not actually easy.
No, let's go to an easier one, like, you know, a valence.
Not valence is not so hard.
I'm kidding.
It's not so hard.
Okay, if you say so. But what a way to be able to test and give it a trial run.
Well, and being a scientist, that is, you know, there's obviously many non-scientists who make great
mm-hmm.
cheese. But being a scientist, it's just
gotta
fun
help.
To work my passion into my hobbies.
Right,
And so it works out really well. And I love the process, and I love mm-hmm. learning about the process, and each thing I learn about the process then makes me want to try a new product.
Exactly.
Right?
And a new thing. And
so it's been a really fun evolution. I'm really excited about it. And we have some amazing cheesemakers in the club.
I know. I've seen it. I've tasted some. And I just am in awe.
Yeah.
And it's really, really cool to see. Blessed are the cheesemakers, like they said. I know I need to get my butt in there and then like just and really try. Like I would want to be one to learn to make.
Yeah.
Because can taste it all day and sell it all day, but got to get in there and get some past that hurdle.
Yeah.
But I too love the Bloomy Rinds. Do you have like when you say a special cave? Did you build like just a little special refrigerator, or do you have a little room in your place for cheese?
So what I did is that using my brewing experience,
mm-hmm.
because the first thing you learn about brewing is the more temperature you control that you have, the better off you are. So mm-hmm. I already had a good sense how to turn a refrigerator or a freezer into a temperature-controlled environment that I could really get accurate temperature. And it's become extremely cheap.
Yeah.
If you can buy a cheap, used dorm refrigerator
mm-hmm.
and you want to put temperature control on it, you can do it for $30, $40.
Nice.
And
your cave is born.
The next
mm-hmm.
step is humidity.
Yeah.
Now, you can control humidity in just a container with something damp, some damp paper towel.
Right.
You replace it often. You keep your cheese off of it.
Mm-hmm.
But you can control humidity nicely and get your first cheeses going. But if you want to have cheeses grow developing for months, then you're probably going to get tired of babysitting that all the time.
Yeah.
But now, there are also inexpensive humidity controllers.
Mm-hmm.
And you buy a little humidifier that you can buy for $20 on Amazon.
Mm-hmm.
And you plug it in to this controller, and it keeps your humidity at 85% or 90%.
Right. So then you don't have to flip the towels, fill the
bins.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, you know, we've sort of come up with a plan on how you can make using a used dorm refrigerator and make a cheese cave for $100.
This is really good.
You can age a lot of cheese in one of those.
You can. And all this I could learn at the library or from the experts, of course, at
Yeah, so you could
the
you
meetings.
Can get that
yeah.
from the meetings. And I believe Chris might have written up a sheet on it.
Yeah, a little bit.
Or a post somewhere in our Facebook or somewhere.
Yeah.
But it's very straightforward. And we've talked about it at the meetings. People
mm-hmm.
have shared different humidifiers that are used. And
I do remember once Horace sharing all his ingenious kind of ways that he would do different things. He would use certain tools that you might think it's just for your garden, but he's like, no, that works really good in cheese making.
Exactly.
or, you know, and that's just this really creative.
And
so
that's
that sharing of ideas.
For me, that came out of beer making too. Just repurposing things.
Exactly.
You know, you can use an old paddle for, you know, stirring your wort when you're making beer, you know, things like that.
So good. And how rewarding it is to make something for yourself, right?
Indeed.
That, does it give you a good appreciation of, cheeses are expensive,
you know?
They are really expensive. Do you see the value, more value in that, or?
I do, but you know, milk is expensive too,
mm-hmm.
and good milk is really expensive.
Really expensive.
So
yeah, starting right there.
So it can be an investment,
mm-hmm.
and you know, it's good to look for a source of inexpensive good milk.
Yeah.
And people have their ways. I'll just leave it at that.
Exactly. Yes, exactly. we will leave it at that.
That is a great way to go. Mm-hmm. But you know, purchase gallons of pasteurized cow milk at the store work great.
Work great, yeah.
And you just want your cheeses to work out because it gets expensive. You get a pound of cheese per gallon.
Yeah, is that if anyone can really understand that how little solid cheese comes out of a gallon of milk.
So the real revelation for making good aged cheese is to break down and get 4 gallons of milk and make a big 4-pound round so you feel like you can, you know, after 5 months, it's been worth your while.
That 4 gallons, this is what I've got right here. Yeah.
And your cheese is also aged
better.
That's
really good.
If it's bigger.
Yes. See, something that you learn as
but
you go making.
But Brie's, on the other hand, I mean, if camembert size is small, and it's a gallon of milk, and it ages quickly. You know, you can be eating it in 10 days.
10 days.
And
did
they're beautiful.
Okay, not this last year, but the year before at the fair, there was a beautiful camembert cheese. Was that you?
No. This year was the first year I submitted my cheese.
Okay, because there was a beauty.
But there's some great cheesemakers around.
Great cheesemakers around. One, I don't know if you've had any tips, because I know, you know, Peter at Alesmith hosts the meetings and stuff and has talked for a long time wanting to do the Cheesesmith Project, which would be the greatest thing. It would be San Diego's first. When people say, what local cheese do we have? If we're going to have one, it's going to be Peter. And how's that coming?
It's on its way.
Yeah, good.
So, you know, I know there's been inspection and licensing and this and that.
Yeah.
And it's always, you know, two steps forward, one step back.
Sure.
And it's on its way.
On its way, which is good news.
It's definitely on its way.
So I don't think people understand. I think cheese making is almost harder to do, a commercial cheese making operation here, than opening a distillery or seriously a brewery.
Harder.
I mean, a brewery you can open in a snap compared to opening a cheese making facility, which seems so counterintuitive or something.
Milk
but
and
it truly
are a real challenge. In terms
really
of
challenging. Yeah, but I'm glad to hear it. It's so exciting. Yep. And you mentioned Jack Ford of Taj Farms. I know a lot of people, you know, are fortunate enough that he'll share some of the fresh milks that he gets from the goats and everything, which is so super, so that people can learn and experiment and then be with the animals and really see where it comes from. Have you had a chance to dabble into that fresh raw milk? And then have you seen the big difference? Like, what would you say?
I have.
Yeah, you have.
Yeah,
goats.
Fabulous.
I love the goats. Yep. Yeah. And what do you notice?
Well, I mean, when you're dealing with raw milk, the issue is the organisms are already there. Now, you can pasteurize it. I've pasteurized lots of fresh milk, and it's just like any other milk, except it's very high quality and very fresh.
Yes.
And you can also use it. As is, if you're going to age cheese for a long time, it's a good idea to pasteurize it for short age cheeses.
Okay.
And if you're going to age cheese for months, over 2 months is in the industry,
exactly.
The rule is over 2 months.
Sure.
And so if you're going to age your cheeses, then you can use that milk straight, but you'll notice that it acidifies more rapidly.
Okay.
Because
here's
it
the science.
Has the bacteria in it.
Mm-hmm.
And you add bacteria. Some people make it without adding bacteria.
Yeah.
There's some interesting books on how to make cheeses with using all your own bacterial cultures and mold cultures and things like that. You can get as basic about this as you want.
Interesting.
You can go back to the roots.
Back to the true roots. Right? I think a lot of people are wanting to do and
which
doing.
Is wonderful,
and
yeah.
Why
it
not?
Is. And
can.
I've experimented with it a little bit, but I've mostly used added cultures.
Yeah, added cultures to it. Have you tested around with animal-based ones and vegetable-based ones?
The you're talking about rennet?
Mm-hmm.
With rennet, I always use animal rennet.
Yeah.
I know people that use vegetable rennet, and they have no problems.
Yeah.
Some people say if you overdose your vegetable rennet, it gets bitter.
Huh.
But
That's interesting.
It's yeah. I don't think it's an issue as long as you control it well.
Control it all good. Yeah. Yeah, it's so there's so many nuances. We all know, you know, cheese, the core ingredient is milk, but then it's all those little nuances around it, right?
And exactly. And of course there's rennetless cheeses.
Yeah, sure. That you could make too.
Right.
So many choices.
Yeah, it's a big world.
Yeah.
It's a big world
no,
out there.
That's
the
good.
Makers world.
So cheese makers. Yep. If you're kind of not completely into the cheese making, tell us about some of the fun things the club does that's just cheese related. Because
right,
I know you do a lot of things.
So we have at our club meetings, we have sharing of cheeses that are both commercial and homemade.
Mm-hmm.
People bring things that are made with cheese, commercial and homemade.
Ah, nice,
but,
yeah.
Various different dishes.
No, you have a grilled cheese competition
every
year.
And we have a grilled cheese competition every year, which is not what you think it is. I mean, think about dessert grilled cheese with pound cake and mascarpone.
Oh, that
or,
sounds like a winner.
You know, anything you can imagine. Grilled cheeses where the cheese is the outside and other
nice,
things are the inside. You know, so it's
creative.
Really amazing.
Yeah.
People do really impressive things.
Oh, nice.
And we do that right. We cook it all right there in the meeting.
Yeah.
And then we have we just had our macaroni and cheese meeting, which again is not
sounds
what you expect.
Delicious. What
a
did
lot
people
of creative,
do?
Macaroni and
yeah.
cheeses. I did one with all homemade cheese this year.
Okay.
Homemade cheddar style.
Yes.
And shells and broccoli and garlic and, you know, so it was not really a formal grilled cheese. There was a mac and cheese uh-huh. made with chili that had been made out of Jacovesa beer, which is a Mexican chocolate stout that Chris Banker has made with Stone Brewing Company. So
wild.
There was that was an outstanding one.
And they mixed that in the mac and cheese somehow?
It was chili mixed into mac and cheese with the beer.
I'm hungry.
And, you know, all kinds of interesting
yeah.
things. There was pumpkin mac and cheese.
That sounds good, too.
There were some fantastic
yeah,
things.
Some fantastic
mac
things.
Mac and cheese pizza.
Sure. Just sharing. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's
really
that's
great.
Another thing we do. The other thing we do is we have all kinds of sort of off-site events. Sometimes those are just gathered together at Benissimo or Brothers Provisions or somewhere and enjoy some cheese or drink some wine and have some cheese or beer. And then sometimes we do things like this cider and cheese pairing that we just did up at Julian Cider Works in Julian.
Yeah.
We bought all the cheese for that from Benissimo.
Yeah, thank you.
And
support. Yeah.
And people just we
it's
have
fun,
fabulous
right?
cheeses.
And then the
and
pairings,
the
super
pairings,
fun time.
And the pairings is really, you know, it's another experience, another part dimension to the experience.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, Julian Cider Works is on a beautiful piece of property outside of Julian.
How could you complain? The combination of everything.
Place.
Yeah.
So it was a great event.
That's
but
really
we do,
good.
We do things like that each year.
Yeah,
and
super.
And then we have a holiday party where, of course, it's a potluck. Things are generally cheesy.
Yep.
And,
would make sense. Cheesy and beery.
We have a cheese and bubbly pairing for the new year.
Oh, nice.
So
yeah.
We do lots of things surrounding cheese.
Ooh, yes. Sounds good. Your little bloomies would be so good with the bubblies.
Exactly.
Mm.
So we set up, I can't remember, about six pairings. This year I'm part of the pairings because it's the incoming president and the outgoing president. So I'm going to be the incoming president.
Congratulations, Mr. President. Yes.
The outgoing president is
very
Earl
good.
Ittrich. And,
yeah.
And,
okay.
We'll be in charge
and
of the pairings this year.
Super fun. Super
and again,
fun.
We do that. We generally do that at the Unitarian Church in San Diego.
Nice.
So
yeah. So different spots around town and just
different
ways to enjoy cheese
exactly.
in all its forms.
Exactly.
That's awesome. If someone wants to become a member, there's a Queso Diego website.
There is a Queso Diego website and a Queso Diego Facebook page.
Mm-hmm.
You can get the information about meetings from there. We generally announce the presenter of the meeting and, again, of course, when the meeting's going to be and where.
Exactly.
And the events are all up there.
Yeah.
We also now have a Cheese of the Month project where we're encouraging people to make a particular cheese each month and bring it to the next month's
meeting.
Oh,
nice. So let's say October would be cheddars. Or
so
something.
I think October was brine cheeses. So ooh, feta, halloumi.
Yeah, okay.
But it was also our mac and cheese meeting, so it was a lot of cheese.
It's a lot of cheese. Again, this is for Turophiles. This is for cheese lovers.
And so, yeah, you can find the information there.
Okay.
You can join at the club. There is probably a mechanism for joining online, but I'm not sure.
Yeah.
And the membership is $20 per person. Mm-hmm. You get a tremendous amount. You get, first of all, 12 dinners for that by attending the meetings.
That's really
and
cheap.
And then all the rest of what I've described happens at the meetings as well as the associated events. So
that's super.
You get a lot for very little money.
Yeah.
And there is a family membership, too.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's great.
It's just a fabulous deal.
A fabulous group.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we at Venissimo will give all members 10% off on any cheese all the time because we just love the group and the fact of promoting cheese, cheese making, cheese dishes, cheese recipes.
And cheesy people. Should say that there are many sponsors of the club, of which Venissimo is one. And
really
we,
great.
We get discounts from all of them, so that's another great benefit of the club.
It is nice, yeah, for the hobbyist or perhaps for the aspiring professional maker, you know, who knows where it could lead, which
Let's
is really
hope.
Awesome, Kurt. Well, thank you for coming. And everybody, check out Queso Diego and keep eating cheese and have a good day. See you next week. Ciao.
Thanks, Gina.